lesson in political history regarding the fight for independence and so on. I'm going to begin now our first panel, which is entitled Challenging Privilege, Talking About Social Exclusion. I'm honoured to be able to present to you such a diverse and able panel. Challenging privilege is certainly one of the most important things that we as activists at ADEPT have to do. Privilege, of course, is everywhere in our society, and so indeed is social exclusion. It's there in a million ways, some of them are subtle, some of them are certainly not, but we're always sinister. So it's vital as members of the Labour Party that we do talk about social exclusion, but of course, just talking about something is never enough. So I hope this panel and the discussions we'll have here do inspire each one of us. Should we double our efforts to fight privilege and social exclusion in every aspect of our lives, both personal and political, if indeed the two are separate. Sorry, you're in a bit of nerves. I do believe we hardly have a panel here today more suited to the task of inspiring us to do just that. So to begin, I'm going to introduce our first panelist. He is co-founder and executive director of Belong To, which I'm sure we're all aware of is the national support network for LGBT youth in Ireland. He's advocated successfully for policy change in the areas of, areas including education, drug and alcohol policy, and suicide prevention. He's written numerous articles about the experience of LGBT youth and strategies and documents for UNESCO, among others, UNESCO and the Government's Own Action Plan on Bullying. He was also named 2013 Gay and Lesbian Awards Person of the Year. Ladies and gentlemen, please welcome Michael Bannon.
Thank you very much. I think I should have to introduce me with that last award and incidentally, because it always sounds better than what the performance afterwards will be. Thank you very much. I'm going to use some notes tonight to just keep me on track. I found that the longer I do this, the more likely I am to ramble off subject. So I want to say a couple of what I think are very important things about LGBT young people and social exclusion in Ireland today. When I was asked to do this talk, I had a free chat with Marty and he kind of said, well, as you're the only LGBT person on the panel, maybe you'll talk about LGBT people generally. But I'm not going to. I'm just going to specifically talk about youth. So there'll be no mention of gay marriage or any of those issues tonight. I'm sorry. So this year, 2013, is the 10th birthday of Belong To, which, as you've heard, is the national lesbian, gay, bisexual, and transgender youth organisation. But the other thing that we are, we're very proud to be, is we're an activist organisation. We were set up under the understanding that there was injustice in Irish society and that lesbian, gay, bisexual and transgendered young people were particularly getting the brunt of it and that we wanted to change that situation. So I think in many ways we're somewhat different to a lot of youth organisations who don't really see their function as changing society fundamentally. So I'd like to take this opportunity to reflect especially what's been happening for LGBT young people, the gains that have been made, there have been some, the barriers that still exist and the realities that are faced by many LGBT young people who are often positioned in these complex intersections of identity, disadvantage, violence and immobility. Since we began Belong To, we've seen extraordinary changes amongst LGBT young people. They're now coming out much younger and in far greater numbers than ever before. In 2003, in our first year, just 52 young people came to Belong To services. Last year in 2012, the number was over 3,000. During this period, homophobic bullying and LGBT young people's mental health issues have moved from being the peripheral interest, I suppose, of an LGBT community to issues that are now talked about on mainstream radio and mainstream television. High profile figures such as President McAleese and Higgins, actor Colin Farrell, even Ministers Quinn and Francis Fitzgerald have somewhat championed the cause of LGBT young people's rights. All this could and often be read to indicate that our LGBT young people have never had it so good. But I would like to suggest to you tonight that this would be a very cosmetic reading of what's going on and that the situation for LGBT young people today is much more complex than that. So what are the big issues? So one of the big issues in Ireland and throughout Europe is that homophobic bullying and transphobic bullying has been found to be one of the most widespread forms of violence and discrimination experienced by young people. The Anti-Bullying Centre in Trinity found that in the region of 16% of our youth population experience bullying, whereas over 50% of the LGBT youth population experience bullying. In a piece of research that we commissioned ourselves and carried out by the Children's Research Centre in Trinity, it found that there was a 5-year gap between when a young person realises that they're LGBT and when they come out. And that 5-year gap corresponds almost entirely to second level education, and that is the period of greatest vulnerability when it comes to mental health issues for young people. The study also found that half of LGBT young people under the age of 25 had seriously thought of ending their own lives, and that 1/5 of LGBT young people had actually attempted suicide. Young people who experienced homophobic bullying and family rejection were particularly vulnerable to these very serious mental health issues. More recently, a survey by the Fundamental Rights Agency of the EU, a survey of 93,000 LGBT people across Europe. It was very interesting. I was asked to speak on the news about this a little while ago, and the survey was of 93,000 young people, and the interviewer asked me, was it a valid survey? It was 93,000 young people. I was dying to say if it was a survey of 93,000 white middle-class men, would you ask whether it was valid or not? Yeah, I don't
think it would.
Possibly, yeah. But anyway, that survey found that Ireland was doing reasonably okay in many areas of LGBT rights, but when it came to school, they were pretty much almost at the very bottom of the pile, with 93% of Irish respondents saying that they experienced homophobia or transphobia in the schools. But at the very beginning, when I kind of off the cuff that I'm not going to talk about gay marriage, but the reason for saying that, I suppose, is that I think talking about LGBT young people can be really interesting because there is no one issue to talk about. There isn't a single law that can be changed. There isn't a single policy document that will overnight change the situation. I think that's very important to say. So where LGBT young people are having tough times, it can involve a combination of, just for example, poor mental health, poverty, class inequality, homelessness, addiction, violence, abuse, ableism, poor access to education and health, or lack of mobility and choice. These situations can be the result of enduring daily homophobia and transphobia, and important again to say that LGBT young people are much more likely than LGBT adults to experience violence. Young people can often live at the intersections of prejudice, for example, young lesbian travellers, or injustice, for example, LGBT young people who live in abject poverty. In 2010, Belongtu carried out a needs assessment of LGBT asylum seekers and refugees. In interviews, these young people told us that living in direct provision or hostel-style accommodation provided by the state posed major problems, and many had experienced violence, including sexual violence from other residents. They said that coming out as LGBT was rarely possible within the system, and fears of confidentiality and being outed meant that they lived in continuous fear. One young person told us that, other than having food and shelter, the only positive aspect of living in direct provision in Ireland today was the fact that they were free to leave the building. Participation in other aspects of the LGBT community was mixed. At times it was seen as being very helpful, but at other times these LGBT asylum seekers and refugees went into the gay community and experienced racism, particularly in gay venues. It's important also, I think, in the bigger picture to note that despite Article 14 of the Universal Declaration of Human Rights, which states that everyone has the right to seek and enjoy in countries asylum from persecution, Ireland's overall acceptance rate for asylum applications has been less than 5% over the last number of years. We've rejected 95% of asylum seekers in this country. At Belongtu, we spent many years arguing with mainstream services, community workers and policymakers that it is artificial to create a hierarchy of needs for young people which face poverty, health and education at the top, and sexuality and gender identity somewhere towards the bottom. You see, the opposing argument sees sexuality and gender identity as, at best, peripheral and private aspects of a young person's life, aspects that is not really the job of the community worker, youth worker or policymaker to go there. This argument sees LGBT identity very often as a middle-class privilege as opposed to a core vital element of who each person is. It also fails to recognise the interrelatedness of, for example, poverty, violence, drug use, sexuality, gender identity for young people. And it's also disingenuous to young people themselves, whose feedback to us commonly indicates that sexual orientation and gender identity for sure is just one aspect of their identities, but constitutes a very important aspect of their identity. So, the juicy bits. What progress do I think we've made? What are the barriers that still exist? And what do I think needs to be done next? In terms of the gains, there have been some. I'm not going to say this because I met at a Labour convention, genuinely, but there have particularly been a fair few policy gains in the last couple of years. The first one, I think, for LGBT young people came when A commitment in the programme for government was written around homophobic bullying in schools. That commitment resulted in the action plan on bullying, which came out from the Department of Education back in January, which is very strong commitments around school ethos and very strong commitments around tackling homophobic bullying. There are a number of national strategies in the area of mental health which have been significant gains belong to. Secured the inclusion of LGBT people as an at-risk group in the National Action Plan on Suicide Prevention, and also in the National Strategies for Drug and Alcohol Use, which all sound very negative, but in actual effect what has meant to, that has resulted in is something of a state investment into the area. And in terms of school curriculum, Department of Education and partnership will belong to in Glen has issued the first ever curriculum in LGBT identity this year, which hopefully will be rolled out across the country in the coming years. And more recently, belong to in partnership with Mainstream Youth Services, has, is that a picture of me?
Yeah.
Oh, goodness. in partnership with Mainstream Youth Services has developed a national network of LGBT youth groups. Only 4 years ago, 5 years ago maybe, 5 years ago I think, there was only one LGBT youth group in Ireland. There's now 24 LGBT youth groups in Ireland, so that's a huge positive change. But what are the barriers that still exist? What are we still fighting against? Or why aren't we just giving up and closing up and saying the job's done? It's not, that's the reason. One of the biggest barriers, and one of the ones that people continuously find it difficult to talk about in education, is the dominance of the Catholic Church within Irish education, and its teachings, particularly around LGBT people. In light of the findings that I mentioned about homophobic bullying and about mental health earlier, I think we really need to be asking, what is this constant opposition from the Catholic Church on LGBT rights? What's the constant messaging? What does that really do to the LGBT young people who are trying to come out in this country today? We still have, and I know there's a bill coming out soon from Ivana Bacik and a number of people. As it presently stands, Section 37 of the Equality Employment Act still exists. And what that has done over a long period of time has created a culture in schools where being LGBT is just not acceptable. I think very often when we talk about this, when we talk about Section 37, we always talk about teachers. But I think it's really important to think about what effect that has on the LGBT young person in the classroom as well. I spoke about state investment, and for sure there has been an increase in state investment, including from the Minister's office here. But I think it's also very important to note that if a young person goes to a mainstream service at present, or goes to an LGBT service at present, the state investment will be multiples in the mainstream service as it is in the LGBT service, and that's just the reality. I think the national average, or the suggested average, for an investment per young person in a youth service, for instance, is in the region of €200 per year, and with an LGBT youth service at the moment, it's something like €50, so it's a quarter of what the recommended amount should be. And then, of course, there's significant underlying homophobia and heterosexism in Irish society. I suppose that's something that's going to change overnight, but I think it's important that we do remember that homosexuality, or male homosexual sex as such, was only decriminalised in 1993. So what needs to happen from here on out? As I said, there has been some good stuff, there's no doubt about it, but we must continue to work to eradicate homophobic and transphobic bullying so that LGBT young people have a fair and equal shot at life. As young people come out younger and in far greater numbers, I think we're facing new challenges. At the moment, we're working with young people who are coming out as young as 11 and 12, and I think that has really changed the game. And we're now working with the youngest ever out generation as such. And what will that mean for Irish society? It would be ultimately a very, very positive thing. But obviously it means that there needs to be greater supports for LGBT people within their families. At the moment, all the supports exist outside of the families. And I suggest that there is a very significant role for the new Child and Family Support Agency to play in terms of supporting parents of LGBT young people. The economic crisis, as we mentioned numerous times, obviously, the economic crisis has had a hugely detrimental effect on young people, and LGBT young people are not in any way immune from that. And from our work at the moment in Belong To, we're working with young people who are living in poverty in much greater numbers than we were a number of years ago. Basic issues around food and shelter, we never had to deal with those, to be honest with you. Not maybe 4 or 5 years ago, we weren't dealing with those sort of issues, and today we are. I know earlier on there was a mention of the youth guarantee, and I would just say that I would really hope that the youth guarantee is implemented in full, and that it doesn't just become another pilot, new pilot in one part of Dublin perhaps, which I think is a very real risk of happening. The lack of gender recognition for transgender people and exclusion of transgender youth, actually, from almost all the proposals that are circulating at the moment needs to be addressed very urgently. We are working with, in the very beginning, 10 years ago, we were working with transgender teenagers who know what their gender identity is at the ages of 11 and 12, and really should not have to wait until 18 to have their gender recognised. And they also need to be supported not just by the NGOs, who have very little resources to do so, but by the state as well, and by that I mean also medical support. All of this indicates to me that I believe that we need a joined up LGBT youth strategy, one that encompasses health, family life, education, rights, employment, poverty, social services, and also youth supports. This Monday, so finishing up with a little bit of a plug, but it's relevant. This Monday in Dublin, we're hosting the first ever Associated EU Presidency Conference on LGBT Youth and Social Exclusion. One of the outcomes of this conference is going to be the Dublin Statement on LGBT Young People and Social Inclusion, which is basically a series of principles and actions which we hope that the Irish government and the EU institutions will take up to fully support LGBT young people across Europe. We also think that it will make a very good basis for the beginning of a national LGBT youth strategy here in Ireland. So thank you very much for having me down here. I really appreciate it. And I look forward to talking to you all a little bit later on again. Thanks very much.
Michael, our next speaker is someone who I think needs very little by way of introduction for this audience and certainly in this part of the country. I'll be very brief. She, since 2011, has been, and this is quite a title, Minister of State at the Department of Justice, Equality and Defence, with responsibility for, and I hope I get these in the right order, disability, older people, equality and mental health.
I was just chewing on a fox's mint, by the way, which the panel has, and you don't. I said, someone that needs no introduction, that I turned to the person and said, is that me? Genuinely, thank you very much for the invitation, and to the other panel members, and indeed to this, both Ciarán and Michael that have spoken before me. I suppose to a great extent, it does depend on where I am, as to what comes first. I do have responsibility for four different areas, and Brendan Howard tells me that in the last government, there were actually four people doing this job. And that tells you the amount of cutbacks there's been. So I do have responsibility for mental health, disability, older people, and equality. And you know, if you were to take mental health, disability, and older people, there, you know, you kind of say, well, you know, that's all in the sort of general health area. And I know Rosie and myself would have had discussions as to why disability is in health, and you know, that's something I don't necessarily feel it should be, but and it's not a decision I made, so there's nothing we can do about that, Rosalie. That's where we're at, and that's it. But I do think that the one thing that does join it all together is the whole equality piece. I think genuinely that's the piece that brings all of it together. Because I did think that for a considerable time that the equality piece was kind of sitting out there on its own, and whenever I was being introduced, whether it was at a mental health conference and it started off with the first part of the title being mental health, or a disability conference and the first part of the title would be disability, or older persons conference, but equality was always sort of and equality. It was always the last piece in the title. And I actually think it's the piece that brings it all together, that simply brings it all together. Because if we're serious about equality, then what we have to do in terms of older people is that we have to stop thinking about chronological age. We actually just have to stop thinking about it. Stop thinking about it. Because I know people at 50 who need the services, you know, that other people at 80 don't need at all. So we have to stop thinking in chronological age. If it comes to disability, then I've always believed that like equality in terms of male-female, we nearly have to be blind to it, you know, to stop thinking about it. but to take a look at the serious needs of the persons and what they need in terms of supports, and just be blind to it. You know, just it doesn't exist, but what are the needs? And I think that that's where the equality piece comes in. That's really where the equality piece comes in. I spoke this morning at the National Women's Council at their 40th birthday, and as someone said to me before, I'm a dinner, any woman with any sense of dignity wouldn't be celebrating a 40th birthday. They definitely wouldn't be advertising it for the world to know. But I spoke to them, and they launched their strategic plan as well. And it's amazing the way the issues are always nearly still the same. You know, it's the economy. It's integration. It's as Michael has already said, the issues around migration, immigration, all of those things. And ensuring that people of different genders and indeed transgender people are very clearly included in all of that. And that's a very difficult agenda to have, because it is about changing attitudes and changing mindsets. I don't often quote English politicians, but I think Jack Straw is worth quoting. He was being interviewed one Sunday morning at 7 o'clock by David Frost, and at the end of the interview, and he was Minister for Inclusion, I think was the title he had at the time in England. And David Frost said to him, "But Minister, you can't legislate for attitudes." And he said, "Well, that's right, I can't. But I can legislate to ensure that your attitude doesn't affect him." And I think that's really where we're at in terms of the agenda about equality. I think that's really where we're at, to ensure that the legislation we're now putting in place and how we change attitudes by that legislation, and you know, we have done that. And it's not just this government that has done it, but we have changed attitudes with legislation. And we've done it in relation to the Equal Status Act. You know, we've done it in relation to all sorts of different pieces of legislation. And we have changed attitudes with legislation by ensuring that people in frontline services, you know, when they meet a certain person of a particular profile, you know, do not have their personal prejudices imposed on that person. That's hugely important. Vitally important. And we need to continue on down that road. We need to continue on saying that equality is something that doesn't just affect men and women, but affects everyone. Equality of access in relation to education. Equality of access in relation to health. Equality of access in relation to our social services. People have the right to be treated equally. But equally doesn't mean the same. Equally means, to a great extent, having the right to the same aspirations. That's really what it should be about, having the right to the same aspirations. You know, being able to say that if I wish to go to third level, that it is available to me. That, you know, if I wish, you know, to have a particular lifestyle, that unless I'm not breaking the law, or unless I'm not, you know, out causing mayhem in the community, I have a right to that. I have a right to my personal integrity. And that's really what the only thing that governments can do. Now, government equally, of course, has to ensure that various groups and different groups who have specific agendas in relation to supporting diverse groups within communities are supported and belong to as one of the groups, I suppose. I'm saying this probably because you're here more than anything else, but I would have to say that Belong To is one of the groups that, because of their submission in relation to homophobic bullying in school in particular, you know, got the funding in order to put a program in place. Because the one thing we did discover in relation to all of the research, is that that is the single traumatic period in the life of a gay person, that 5-year gap, you know, when you have the knowledge of your own sexuality but are not prepared or haven't got the confidence to come out and be open about it. And what frightens me about that kind of bullying, you would often say that young children, you know, don't have the knowledge or the understanding in terms of the impact that it has on people's lives. They do. They very clearly do. Because they use it not just towards people whom they may suspect. Now, suspect is nearly the wrong word. Is that suspect the wrong word? Right. Suspect may be gay. But they actually use it against everyone. And you know, it's the using it against even people that clearly are not gay. You know, and that type of, you know, using it as that type of insult or that type of weapon clearly shows you that they know exactly what they're doing. That they know exactly what they're doing. And that's the type of attitudinal change that we need to bring about. We seriously need to bring about change in relation to how people treat others. And that's the most difficult task of all. That is the most difficult task of all. During the Irish presidency, and just saying to someone coming up the stairs that there are 16 more days to go in our presidency. When people start counting down the days, you know there's a very good reason for it. I reckon that if this presidency doesn't finish soon, there'll be someone found in the plane. And I'm just worried that it might be me. But our presidency took a particular line in relation to equality. And, you know, the emphasis that we put on it has never been there before. We've had four major conferences in Dublin on equality alone. Yesterday, I was in Brussels launching with President Van Rompuy. I mean, you know, why not? I just love these names. I always think that people were name dropping when they'd say it, you know, I now realize they're just very important people. That's a joke, by the way, in case you think I'm serious. But I was in Brussels yesterday and I was launching this equality index for the whole of the European Union. And it's an incredible tool because they took the 27 countries, including one accession country, and they measured how well each country is doing in relation to equality, how well they're doing it in relation to equality. And basically what they discovered was that in four of the six areas that they measured, we're doing extremely well. Knowledge, for instance, we're doing very well. 60% of all degrees conferred in Europe are conferred on women. We're doing extremely well in health. You know, our health statistics are going up, we're living longer, all of that. We're doing very badly in relation to employment and power. We do not have an equality in relation to the corporate sector when it comes to boards. We simply don't have it. 8% of women on corporate boards. Women, because of their position of dipping in and out of the workplace, whether it's because of childcare or caring for another person in their family, or indeed, you know, just simply taking time out in terms of their employment, they actually end up with less social contributions at a later life, which in fact contributes to them falling into poverty as they age. So all of that information is out there. And all of that information is available to us. And so therefore, they're the things we have to look at. And we have to start looking at things differently. It's not the same old, same old. You know, it's not about throwing money at things. It's about changing attitudes, making us blind, ensuring that, and we all have them, ensuring that our prejudices don't affect others. And we've done that to a great extent with legislation down through the years, but we need to do more. We simply need to do more. You know, when I sit down with different groups every week, I find more and more, it's the subtlety now. You know, you're no longer told that they would prefer to have, that their clients expect to meet at the desk, you know, white, middle-class man. You're no longer told that. You may not get the job, and the white middle-class man may appear at the desk, but you're no longer told. It's the subtlety of it. And we need to be conscious of the subtleties. And it's more difficult to deal with in terms of that subtlety. Far more difficult to deal with. I mean, for instance, education and homophobia. You won't hear the teacher or the principal, you know, talking about the young lad or the young girl who's gay. You won't hear it. But it's the kind of subtlety of the Asher, what's wrong with you? You know, everyone gets bullied. What's the problem? You know, instead of confronting it head on. And we need to do that. And we need to do that. And we need to confront these things. We need to confront them. And all of those things have the effect of excluding us. Excluding us from certain areas. And in the areas that I'm responsible for, mental health, disability, older people, and equality, I would have to tell you that the biggest problem we face in all of those areas is isolation. And the type of bullying and exclusion we see in relation to all of those areas leads to people becoming isolated. And isolation is a major problem. Is a major problem. Someone develops a mental health problem. They lose their job, they lose their friends, they usually lose their families, and they become isolated. Someone with a disability, if they lose their family through the natural course of events, and they're on their own, you know, they become quite isolated unless they have their own group. People who develop Alzheimer's, you know, as I say, we're all eventually going to develop, we're all eventually going to acquire a disability. We are all eventually going to acquire a disability. My husband tells me I'm deaf in one ear. I keep telling him as to what he's talking at. But we will all eventually acquire a disability. And that, even that deafness piece, can make us quite isolated. Quite isolated. And isolation is the major problem. It's the major, major problem. We're about to publish an enormous piece of legislation which has been promised for the last 20 odd years, I think. As long as I'm involved in politics, this piece of legislation has been promised. And when I got this job first, the very first conference I attended was Inclusion Ireland. And Inclusion Ireland is an organisation that I had a lot of contact with. It's an advocacy organisation in relation to people with disabilities. And when I got the job, that same week I had already promised to go to a conference, not realising that I was going to get this job. So I went anyway. And Sean O'Rourke was the moderator on the day, and he said, right, what are the three things? I said, I'm only going to try and do three things in each of the areas I'm responsible for. And he said, right, what are the three things you're going to do in relation to disability? Well, I said, I'm going to get inspections in relation to people who live in institutions and who have a disability. I said, and we're going to get the capacity legislation. It's called the mental capacity legislation, but we're hoping to change that, but for legal reasons, it's the capacity legislation. Assisted decision-making capacity legislation. And I said, individualized services. And as I was coming down off the stage, now these are things that have been promised for 20 years. As I was coming down off the stage, this woman that I've known for a long, long time, and who is hugely involved in disability, caught me by the elbow and she said, you'll never get them. I said, we'll see. The inspections in relation to people who live in institutions and have a disability will be starting in September, and the mental capacity legislation will be published soon. And that piece of legislation will affect each and every person in this room. Each and every person in this room. Maybe not now, but eventually, it will affect each and every one of us. Basically what it is to ensure that people, wherever they find themselves in life, have a legal right to be heard, to be listened to be respected, and their decision to be abided by. Even in the event that you lose complete capacity and you have to be admitted to a psychiatric unit, your will and preference will have to be listened to. Your will and preference will have to be listened to. And if you cannot express that will and preference yourself, then you can appoint someone to express it for you. And they will have to be listened to. And it's pieces of legislation like that that not alone will change our lives and our world, but will change our attitudes. And will change the attitudes of people who have the power to decide what happens to us. Mm-hmm. who have the power to decide what happens to us. One piece of legislation, which I think no one ever refers to, which I always thought was probably the most profound of all, was one which was introduced by Mervyn Taylor. And Mervyn Taylor introduced a piece of legislation that was just one page, just one page. And I always believe, have always believed, that history is always written by the victor, you know? And history is always about the grand event. And usually the victor is a man, so therefore it's always about war. No one disagrees with that, isn't that amazing? But Mervyn Taylor introduced a piece of legislation. And basically what it did was allow women's occupation, the mother's occupation, to be registered on the birth certificate. And for the first time ever, we had a social history of what mothers did. Up to that point, it was only the father's occupation, and it was as if women had no contribution to make in relation to society, the economy, or the market. And that piece of legislation, I believe, changed how we looked at statistics from there on in. And it will equally feed in to the equality index in Europe. There is one thing missing off the equality index. There is no information about violence. None. Not a single bar on violence. They simply couldn't get it. And they didn't want to put in one country and leave out another, because that would have distorted, you know, it would have made one country then look extremely good as opposed to having none from the other. But the amazing thing is that the one thing everyone agreed on was the one piece that was missing, was the one piece we all knew existed. You know, the other pieces, we were a little bit surprised at where certain countries came and all the rest of it. But that was the one piece that we all agreed on, and yet it is completely missing. So I do think that we have made progress, I would have to say that. And I've equally always said that the agenda in relation to equality and inclusion will never be completed. Because as soon as you have done one thing, there will be something else. And I'll just leave you with this. If we are educating most, those we employ least, which we are, what if CVs had to be denuded of anything that to indicate either what gender you were or where you came from? I'd love to know who'd be called for interview. Thank you.
Has consistently represented the interests of unparented families, women, and people in poverty. Ladies and gentlemen, Frances Byrne.
Hi, thanks a million for asking me. I'm really delighted to be here. And I was listening to the minister talking about the word gay, and my darling son, who's about the same age as the average age in this room, he gave me a lot of trouble when he was a teenager, but the biggest row that ever happened during those times wasn't about drinking or other things, it turned out he was up to, or the morning I had to get him from Stuart Street Guard Station. The biggest row was when we were in a Clark's in the Blanchardstown Centre, and we're looking at a school bag, I'm not getting that gay. Because it was a streak of pink in it, and the word gay had become a horrible word. But anyway, this is what always happens. I prepare like a good woman, and then I get distracted by all the stimulation of previous people, and I'm adding Michael to the list of people I never want to follow in public speaking again. But I had a fangirl moment as I tweeted, because I just think that their work is, I just think Belongtu's work is so important. But anyway, the reason that I was delighted to accept Lisa's invitation a good while ago now is because the theme of your whole weekend, and particularly this panel, is something that's very close to Oakland's heart. Our families have often felt locked out, and austerity, I'm afraid, has increased the isolation that the minister was just describing. And there has been a hardening of attitudes towards us and towards other groups in society. And of course, during and since the 1913 lockout, many of our families have also been locked into Magdalen laundries and other institutions, or situations which obliged us to live lives of slavery or violence, or both, and in some cases to give up our children forcibly. But in 2013, we have growing concerns about one-parent families and others, and some of our communities. And I'd like to talk about these concerns through the lens of the lone parents who Open represents and who lead us every day. First, though, I'd like you to note two things, and they're going to sound contradictory, but bear with me. There are other lone parent organisations in Ireland, but Open has the centre of our work, those lone parents who are living in poverty. That is, either entirely dependent on a social welfare payment, or partly dependent and also at work, because you're still allowed to do that just about, or full-time working but on low pay. Nevertheless, and this is going to sound contradictory, while those families are our chief focus, everything on our policy wish list, all the aspiration and ambition that we have for one-parent families, we also want for all families in our society. Minister Michael Noonan recently spoke of the need to plan for our post-austerity economy, and my heart sank, because my question for Labour Youth and the wider Labour Party, and indeed all political parties and beyond, in the context of the summer school's theme is, what about our post-austerity society? As an aside, I note that a former leader of your party said that while Labour is a minority partner in the current coalition, you get disproportionate blame, and I just want to say if I got an invitation to a Fine Gael event like this, I'd be thrilled, I'd accept it, and I'd be saying everything that I'm saying now. I want to be really clear about that. The as yet untold story or misunderstood story of austerity, in our opinion in Open, is what has happened to the very heart of the community sector in Ireland. But allow me first to focus on the told story. One parent families, and Deputy Lynch referred to this earlier when he was speaking. He didn't name us, but he did say that some groups have paid a high price, and we have. Independent think tanks, as well as the Department of Social Protection itself, have highlighted the disproportionate impact of recent budgets on lone parents. And if you don't believe me, see welfare.ie for their latest thing on the latest budget. Alongside this, so-called reform of the main social welfare payment for one-parent families is in train, and indeed Labour Youth were the first political party to pick up the phone to Open after this happened. Open's analysis, as many of you here know, is that the reform, so-called reform, is ill thought out and will punish those in work. And this isn't our subjective view. The department itself has identified once-off savings of 7.6 million in 2015, every cent of which will be taken from working lone parents. This flies in the face of successive government policy, with which we fully concur, by the way, that work is the best route out of poverty. Dependency on welfare is never going to get anybody out of poverty. Thousands and thousands of lone parents who combine caring and working outside the home will face terrible choices, while unemployed lone parents will have to switch payment. That latter group, most of whom are mothers, 98% of our mothers, are the only group of mothers in Ireland who will be activated, by the way lone parents hate that word, by the state. The inference being that lone parents are sitting at home all day painting their fingernails and not doing anything. Anyway. One of the rationales given is the government doesn't want to encourage welfare dependency. Well, so say all of us. We don't want to either. However, even when the payment could be paid until the youngest child was finished third level or had reached the age of 22 years, which we did not agree with at all, the average length of stay was just 6.1 years, according to the minister in her own statement to the Shannon last year. In a country like this, which has seen a complete lack of investment in childcare historically, and we know it was one of the biggest wastes of the boom, 6 years does not sound like long-term welfare dependency to anyone, surely. Speaking of childcare, the government promised that in the absence of developing a comprehensive Scandinavian system here, and I've no doubt that Labour Youth brought a lot of pressure internally to bear to get that promise, and I hope that Open played its part as well, that the further eligibility reforms, where the youngest child would go from 14 to 12 to 10 to 7, would not proceed. Astonishingly, even though the same government has now admitted that this badly needed childcare investment cannot or will not happen, the changes are proceeding, but with a special job seekers payment for those who were previously on the one-parent family payment. We have an impression in Open that the hard-working and exemplary officials in the department came up with this solution. We wish, though, that the hard-working minister and others at the cabinet table, and indeed not at it, had admitted the policy failure and kept the original promise. We say this not because, and we say it with a very heavy heart, not because we disagree with the project to begin with, which we do, nor because the so-called reforms fly in the face of the commitment that was actually the programme for government, by the way, which we assume Labour put there. In fact, we're 99.9% positive. But because we believe that a promise once made should be kept. And this brings me back to the untold story of austerity, but please hold that thought about promises. The story that we in Open thinks need to be told, alongside what I've outlined already, is a story we think will have untold consequences for our society, for everybody in our society, and will slow down any chance we have of a real inclusive recovery, what Deputy Lynch referred to earlier when we get out of the bailout, etc. Unless all of us, including you, the politicians and activists of the present and future, do something about it. That's up to you, of course, but I won't be able to look my future grandchildren in the eye unless I try to persuade you and others. And other community leaders are also trying to highlight this, but we're up against the austerity project itself, mainstream media that has largely bought into the said project, albeit with some great exceptions, and a public that is in rapid danger under the pressures many are feeling to only have room in their own consciousness for their own immediate and urgent concerns, very understandably. Again, this is not universal, and there are some inspiring examples of solidarity and joint initiatives, such as Claiming Our Future, Spectacle of Defiance and Hope, and Ballyhay Says No on the go. The truth is that the previous government quite simply wreaked havoc on the community sector at local and national levels. And our sector wasn't alone. The Combat Poverty Agency was taken out, the Equality Authority, which the Minister now has responsibility for, was seriously and irreparably damaged. The National Consultative Committee on Racism and Interculturalism was wiped off the face of the earth virtually overnight. Most of this is known about and was condemned at the time by your party and others. However, prior to the economic crash, there was a review undertaken of local groups, and also completely without public debate or knowledge, the previous government dismantled its own policy on the relationship between the state and the community and voluntary sector. So what, you might say, be 400,000 people unemployed, get your priorities right, Francis. Fair enough. Well, along with subsequent cuts to funding, this means that hundreds of disadvantaged communities are now without vital resources, or have resources like centres, like support staff, like programmes and services that are under enormous pressure. This coincided with the annihilation of the National Anti-Poverty Network scheme and unprecedented cuts to core funding for national organisations. So there is no way that Open as a national network or others can step into the breach in terms of meeting local needs, nor should we have to, nor would it be appropriate. It's worth emphasising that these reviews, which preceded austerity, led to amalgamations and funding withdrawal from some groups and were carried out behind closed doors and were not subject to consultation with the sector, independent scrutiny or evaluation. So why does it matter? Well, it matters because the people living in those communities, those same communities, are those who have since had their basic social welfare rate cut by the previous government and everything bar their basic payments cut by the current one. Yes, there were reversals to the minimum wage cut and the USC, really important ones. And yes, not everyone in the affected communities is unemployed. But these are the communities which we can all name off the top of our heads in both rural and urban settings, in some cases where we've never even set foot in them. And yes, there are disadvantaged people beyond those areas too. The scandal of this recession, or at least it will be in the future, is not just the national disgrace that is Priory Hall or the ghost estates. It's also the cumulative income and services cuts which have been heaped upon those who saw little or no benefit from the Celtic Tiger. The families who still continue to queue for everything, health services, day-old bread, their social welfare payments. The newer communities which have lost out on investment or had thoughtless planning which didn't include them. I live in one. Leading to shortages of schools, doctors, playgrounds and community settings. I started out asking you, friends, where was the plan for our post-austerity society? Maybe I should have asked, where's the plan for the one that's in austerity? We never really did step back as a country when the crisis hit. The new government which took office in March 2011 really should have, or at a minimum stood by pre-election promises or the programme for government commitments, all of them. But one has the impression that the incoming government was in deep shock. I remember seeing images of Minister Burton in particular, and she was white as a ghost coming out of the Department of Finance, and now we know why. But it's not too late. And I hope I haven't wrecked everyone's balls, as my son says to me. Or sometimes he says to me, stop playing the smallest violin in the world, Mom, and tell us how we're going to solve this. I believe it's not too late. As someone said at the beginning of a social movement in the United States, there's an urgent need for long-term planning. What could we do? Well, for a start, we could all read the spirit level. by Wilkinson and Pickett. I'm deadly serious. We need to understand the incredible effects of unequal societies. The costs are considerable and catastrophic for everyone. And at this stage, unless drastic action is taken, Ireland is going to end up being an even more divided society. Income inequality matters. Health inequalities matter. Housing and education apartheid matter. And if inequalities are allowed to continue or worsen, guess what? We all end up paying, not just the people in the communities we can all rattle off. One way or the other, inequality costs. There is an economic case and there is a moral imperative. I'm not laying this at the foot of the Labour Party or any of its constituent parties. This is everyone's work. At Open, we're trying to do our bit by trying to get a programme off the ground with an initial investment from the Community Foundation to empower young parents and others to get involved and engaged in their communities in this new context. To get lone parents to take better care of ourselves. Parenting alone is hard work. I've been doing it for a long time, and believe me, underneath all this blonde and white-haired and grey-haired. And combined with social activism, it's important we mind ourselves and each other. And finally, to encourage lone parents and others to register to vote or to otherwise engage in civil and political life. Friends, we need to reimagine our communities and our wider society. Things weren't okay before the bust. And the impact of growing inequality, broken promises, as I can't emphasise enough, and pretendy evidence-based policy making, is turning people right off the political system. So we need together to conceive better and different ways to engage with a renewed, or at least a renewable politics, and restore the badly damaged trust, which in itself is a byproduct of inequality. Sometimes when I'm up in Smithfield in Dublin, where Open is based, and I'm feeling very down or I'm wondering, what's it all about? I imagine that I'm an alien visiting from a galaxy far, far away. My father was a Star Trek fan. In fact, he still is. There are questions I pose to our society and to its political leaders in particular. Where is the quality affordable childcare? And why do we force parents to make impossible choices? Why do we let down children in so many areas, but never more so than those who can't live with their own parent or parents or who have additional needs? Yesterday we discovered, or rather rediscovered, 100 plus children are in adult psychiatric settings in this country. So wrong. Why are we providing services for people with disabilities and older people, which the Minister has spoken about so eloquently, with and without disabilities, using private services or on a for-profit basis? But I would also have a question which would underpin all others. Why are we still living with or busy implementing policies which are informed by a set of values which have utterly failed us and have in fact brought our beautiful, bright, funny, warm people to their knees? You don't need to complete a course or to get a degree in anything but life itself to know that neoliberal values remain the order of the day still, and that as a result unfairness reigns. And these are the very same values which gave us light regulation, poor and corrupt planning, and the privatisation of care and support services. The if we build it, they will come, and they will pay for it too mentality. And by God, are we paying. That thinking didn't work before. It can't work now. Those values will absolutely not get us out of the mess we're in. Our politics, and it is all of our politics, refusing to really change, and politicians making and breaking promises, cause an already fragile trust to crumble. Growing inequalities undermine any faith in the ability of a society to then restore itself. This is borne out in the Wilkinson and Pickett research and in Open's work every day and throughout the communities which should be at the forefront of our concerns. The title for my speech is "It Takes a Strong Village to Raise a Child." It does indeed take a village to raise a child. It does indeed take a strong village with citizens. And I use that term the way our president uses it, in the most inclusive way possible. Citizens who feel involved and valued because they really are. It takes sturdy families which are not locked out of hope because the austerity project continues to copper fasten the notion of a deserving and an undeserving poor. And it takes communities which no longer feel left behind and excluded or as if they just don't matter. Friends, this is all of our work. So what are we waiting for? Thank you.
Neoliberalism, and I'll certainly be dusting off my copy of the Spirit Level. Our final panellist tonight is Rosalind McDonough. She is a disability and travellers' rights advocate and one of the traveller community's leading feminist voices. She's been working with Abbey Point for some 10 years and has managed their Violence Against Women programme, which aims, and I'm quoting here from the website, to develop a traveller analysis of violence against women that will inform the development of culturally appropriate responses for traveller women and influence government policy. She's also a member of the National Women's Council of Ireland and the Independent Living Movement. Rosalind's prepared a speech today, which will be delivered to us by our very own Julianne Cox.
Okay, so the title of Rosalind's speech is Being Kicked Around. And it opens with a quote from Martin Collins, who is co-director of Abbey Point. These cuts to traveller projects and services are short-sighted and will only serve to condemn another generation of our community to exclusion and discrimination. The phrase political football gets overused. However, in the context of travellers in Ireland, we as a community have been kicked from pillar to post and offside for a number of years by successive governments. Travelling with austerity impacts of cuts on traveller projects and services. The report launched by Abbey Point in late April 2013 gives a stark account as to how austerity is affecting the traveller community and specific traveller initiatives since 2008. The social research was carried out by Brian Harvey. The report highlights the important contribution that community development has made to our struggle and gives the background to the development of the traveller infrastructure in Ireland over the past 30 years. It highlights the shift from a charity to a human rights model informed by community development principles of empowerment, self-determination, and traveller participation. Social solidarity with other marginalised groups began and sustained itself throughout our 30-year struggle. Racism was named and acknowledged as a reality for travellers. Understanding women's human rights, pulling and stretching the cultural boundaries was all part of the principles of community development. Travel organisations such as Abbey Point were creating safe spaces where sensitive issues such as domestic violence, feuding and drug misuse could be discussed within the community. This community development also includes work in Europe and relationships between other minority ethnic nomadic groups and their governments and policymakers. In particular, the Roma community. It is this very work and infrastructure which is now threatened by government proposals on alignment and subsuming community development into local authorities. The report seeks to highlight the positive developments that have resulted through community development and make a case for the need to support the continuance of independent travel organisations at national and local levels if our struggle for our human rights is to continue and develop. The report also documents the cuts to funding for traveller projects and services since 2008. It paints a shocking picture and details disproportionate cuts to the traveller sector. Using the government's own figures and report, the report highlights overall cuts in government expenditure of 4.3%, while the cuts to traveller services include traveller interagency activities, cuts of 100%. Traveller education saw cuts of 86.6%. Cuts to traveller accommodation amount to 85%. Equality, 76.3%. National traveller organisations, 63.6%. False special initiatives for travellers, a cut of 50%. And health saw a cut of 5%. Of equal concern is the fact that there are significant underspends in the funds allocated by many government departments. A quote from Ronnie Fay, who is the co-director of Abbey Point, illustrates this fact. Political choices detrimental to travellers are being made using the guise of austerity and presented as economic choices. The other telling element of this report was the disproportion in the specific cuts to the traveller sector in context of austerity on the wider population. And a quote from Brian Harvey, researcher on the report, Travelling with Austerity. highlights this fact. Granted the fall in budgets for the voluntary and community sector, about 35%, I had expected something similar for travellers, but was shocked at the actual figures, which were much higher than anything I had expected. Cuts in community and employment schemes, cuts in education services, cuts in social welfare, including childcare, all add up to a community that has very little state investment in it. Core funding for traveller organisations is smaller than ever. The eradication of local traveller groups causes desolation and isolation within the community. Trying to tackle existing issues with new and emerging ones with little or no budget. This has a detrimental impact on morale within the community. For a lot of travellers, the only realistic opportunity of employment and lifelong learning is with the travel organisation. The significant issue in relation to youth reach programmes is that most travellers are married with a family to support by age 20. The report highlights various issues in the area of accommodation. Increases in rents and lack of provision of new traveller-specific accommodation forces many into private rented accommodation, isolated and vulnerable because they are away from their family network and the wider community supports, which can lead to depression and increased use of alcohol and other drugs and their potentially associated antisocial behaviours. However, the reality is now that families are doubling up in bays on sites because private rental accommodation often means that landlords want rent allowance topped up. People do not have that kind of money. Cuts are damaging to the traveller families. Three meals a day is not always possible for some. Heating is seen as a luxury that most people try to do without. School uniforms and books are not always connected to a second-hand or free scheme. Stress on top of stress in families is causing havoc. Travellers living alone, whether disabled, gay or older, are at multiple risk. They don't always have much money to live on. Poverty experienced by an individual or family unit, whether you are settled or traveller, can and does ratchet up mental health issues. Despite 30 years of political lobbying, social, personal and public activism, our lives are unchanged. In 2010, the All-Ireland Traveller Health Study was launched. The statistics tell a stark reality of how another two generations are affected by discrimination, racism and marginalisation. The parameters of the racism experienced by travellers has changed over the past 10 years. A more covert racism, a harsher racism, and a more difficult racism to challenge has emerged. Civil and public servants via social policy carry a diktat about what and how much public resources are put into travel organisations and travel infrastructure in the wider policy arena. This practice facilitates public officials with power overtly pursuing an assimilation mindset. It also creates a paranoid and competitive environment within the community and NGO sector, whereby groups are competing for the same pot of money which has shrunk. Assimilationist attitudes, practices and provision, which have been hidden behind a rhetoric of equality over the past 10 years, are once again evident. The mantra, "we have no resources," allows public officials to cut back on traveller-related expenditure. A worrying trend is that mainstreaming has become assimilation as the traveller-specific supports disappear. This is particularly evident in education. Austerity made it easier to remove supports and initiatives in the area of education under the guise of removing a segregated system. The ultimate cop-out. Services that were discontinued in 2011, including the visiting teacher service for travellers and the system of resource teachers for travellers. All 33 senior traveller training centres were closed in 2012. Travel organisations had advocated a phasing out of these centres to enable participants to engage with mainstream education. This has not happened. These services rebalance the lost years and the lost generations of travellers who are failed by the education system. In the coming years, we as a community will experience the fallout of these cuts. The austerity report articulates the dangers of the cuts that have decimated our community. Traveller organisations will not be given the resources necessary to do the work that needs to be done with another generation. Equality will get defined as a luxury for when the government has a more disposable income. The abolishment of external state agencies such as Combat Poverty, Equality Ireland, Irish Human Rights Commission. Equality Authority, Irish Human Rights Commission, the National Action Plan on Racism, the NCCRI, impacts on travellers' infrastructure and the community. In everyday life, racism is the backlash in the form of, aren't they getting it all? And this has all gone too far. And why aren't they more grateful? This means travellers who are deemed successful can be drawn away from our community and our cultural roots, creating division, new rejection, and maybe even a redefinition of traveller identity. Mainstreaming without equality mechanisms being put in place can and does cause division within our community. Antisocial behaviour grows. This enables stereotypes to deepen. This creates new isolations, enabling self-destruction individually and collectively. Previously, travellers struggled to put cultural diversity on the agenda. Now it is on the agenda. There is a very different struggle for travellers now. The struggle to be acknowledged as part of the cultural diversity in Ireland. The day is drawing near when Ireland will recognise travellers as a minority ethnic group. Thus, in turn, redress the balance by ensuring travel organisations and infrastructure is well resourced to do the vital advocacy work. Being kicked around by the state and its civil servants would make it seem that the traveller infrastructure are not in the premiership, nor do they draw the crowds or the cat choruses that are often heard at rugby games. A strong referee, a good manager, would be a metaphor for a traveller agency that would tackle all the own goals that the state keeps scoring. And that finishes the speech.
Julianne, we have about half an hour now, I think, so I think we'll open up to questions.
Four?
Oh, we've more than half an hour, that's it. So I think we'll take them in groups of three, but I can get 18 here. So, hands up, please. Oh, and I've been asked to say, please, if we could keep the speeches to a minimum, that would be fantastic. Thanks very much. So I suppose Connor and Rory, I don't see anyone else.
I'd like to start by thanking all the speakers for what was a very interesting and thought-provoking panel. Question specifically for Mr. Cathy Lynch. You mentioned the mental health legislation about allowing all people to have their wishes carried out. Just wonder how this applied to those who have been sectioned.
Thanks very much, Jack. Just my question is a little bit, I suppose, cynical, because I'm renowned for being cynical, so I thought I had to keep my reputation. I woke up this morning basically about 4:30 to a phone call from a friend of mine from Brazil, basically about what's happening there, where police fired into a crowd of peaceful protesters a week after saw similar events in Turkey, the same week that the public broadcaster in Greece has been shut down, a week after we've seen a young man beaten to death by fascists in Paris. And then the same week that we see Russia pass retrenchment law on gay rights, basically banning people from defending gay people in public. And I've been involved in Labour Party for 10 years, and I've been involved in Irish politics for 10 years, and it's just probably the most depressing week I've ever been involved in politics. And I've kind of woke up today and said, is there any point anymore? I suppose to each of the speakers, I'd like to ask, do you think there's any point anymore? And what is that point? So thanks.
Do we have a third question at the moment? No. Oh, yeah.
Sorry, just to the minister here. I commend you on the work that you're doing about equality and that in the workplace, especially for people going for jobs. But evidence we've seen from other countries where they've legislated for equality, positive discrimination has set in and actually increased the right-wing element that's gone in these countries as a result of it. What do you plan on doing to try and stop that from coming in?
I don't quite understand that now, but maybe when we get to it, you might sort of expand on it. In relation to people that are sectioned, then it's actually quite a small few of people that are sectioned in this country. I think what usually happens is that people go or are persuaded to go to the acute unit and on a voluntary basis. And then when they decide that they sort of no longer want to stay there because they're voluntary patients, they become very quickly involuntary. And so therefore, you know, they are detained. So, you know, I think that's really where the greater issue is, and the review of the Mental Health Act, which is going on as we speak, I'm hoping we'll deal with that. There are just three issues that I asked them to deal with, and they'll deal with everything, but there's just three I asked them in specifically to deal with. It's just, when does that occur and how does it occur? How does that sort of, I'm a voluntary patient and all of a sudden I'm involuntary and so therefore I have no longer freedom of movement. How does that occur? Well, the mental capacity or the assisted decision-making capacity legislation, because we will be able to make each and every one of us, those who wish to, and I'm assuming that people who have sort of ongoing difficulties with their mental health, even though I always look at mental health as kind of like body odor. You know, you may have it this week, but it might be gone next week. But, you know, I just think that sort of advanced directives whereby you can actually say, you know, in the event that I have another episode of poor mental health, this is what I want to happen. Or I don't want ECT, by the way, which is coming out. The unwilling part in relation to ECT is coming out. It's not the full hog, but I think it's an advance. So that sort of advance directive actually still stays in play, even though you're sectioned or you become an involuntary patient. And in that case, because we have to accept that there are clearly, from time to time, I believe far fewer than we imagine, but there are times when in fact people do have episodes of acute mental ill health where they in fact are a danger to themselves, and they're very seldom a danger to others, but a danger to themselves. And I think that in that event, that the advance directive in that piece of legislation will have a huge impact, because you can then appoint someone to ensure that your will and preference is adhered to. Not certain if we go far enough to say that in terms of needing medication, that I don't want absolutely any medication. Even the most liberal or revolutionary of people in relation to mental health would say that there are times and in certain circumstances where medication does help to stabilise the person in order to, you know, get therapies in. So I think it will have that kind of an impact. Is there any point? Geez, Rory, I've nights like that too. Is there any point? Rory, I think your opening remarks tells me that if we're not here, what is there to stop the fascists? You know, or what is there to stop the type of advance of the right in Europe? And it is everywhere. I mean, Greece is quite worrying. There are other accession countries within Europe that are actually quite worrying as well. Russia, I mean, not certain that, you know, who was it said they were keeping an eye on? John, who was it said they were keeping an eye on? The Skibbereen Eagle, was it? Was keeping an eye on Russia. But you know, I'm not certain that we can have, but that's the point. I mean, that is seriously the point. You know, we're not doing everything right. Of course we're not. We'll never do everything completely right. You know, we wouldn't be human if we did. I mean, and I'm not certain that I'd like to live in that kind of Stepford kind of utopian society. I'm not certain I want to live there. You know, I think it's part of the human condition to actually be challenged and make mistakes and say, I made a mistake, or to do things differently. And hopefully that you would get 50% of it right. But that's the human condition. But the point is, Rory, that there is a point. And the point is that if you're not here, and I'm not here, to stand up and say, you shouldn't do that, and that we're prepared to, you know, take the slings and arrows of outrageous foes, then, you know, that is the point, Rory, and there is a point. No.
Sorry, just
to rephrase there, the point I'm making was you were talking about opening up jobs that were normally reserved for the middle class white man.
Yeah.
Like, that's a brilliant concept, you know, 100% behind it, but the point is what happened in the States when they brought in legislation to do that, and in the UK and South Africa, was we had people coming in who were minorities going for these jobs, but weren't qualified enough for the jobs, but because of the legislation, they gave the jobs to the person. I actually know of a case in South Africa where they hired pilots for ships from the blacks, and they couldn't drive the ships, and then they were crashing ships all over Durban Harbour.
Okay. I don't know if that particular incident, and anyway, but could I say that this is not about positive discrimination for people who can't do the job. That's not. No one wants that. That's not what it's about. It is about everyone having an equal chance, having the same aspirations, a level playing field, that it's not just about your address or what gender you are. You know, we educate most those we employ least. We educate most those we employ least. And I'm not, you know, I'm not here to tell you that just because someone has a master's or a PhD, that they are the right person for the job, no matter where they come from. I'm not going to tell you that. I have met people that have been in college for 30 years and I wouldn't even mind my dog. You know, that's a fact. That's a fact. You know, this is about the right person for the job. This is about the right person for the job. And that the prejudices that we all hold should not affect people. No, it is not about ensuring that people who are not the right person for the job gets the job. Not at all what it's about. I would be the first person to say, and I don't do subtlety as people know, but I would be the first person to say, you know, sack it. He's useless. Get rid of him. You know, you have to be able to do the job. I would have to tell him equally that there are some people who, if they got the job and got the right training, would be quite capable of doing it. And I think we can't dismiss that either. You know, what is it? Neil Barrow, a friend of mine, always says that if the world were full of farmers, we'd starve. You know, because there'd be no millers, and there'd be no bakers, and there'd be no one to deliver the bread. And, you know, we don't all have to be rocket scientists. You know, the right approach, I think, is what's important.
Do resume next, and then...
Rory, I'm 20 years older than you, and I have probably more reason to be cynical. But the point is, we're here in the room. I woke up this morning thinking things that I, a small proportion of Irish society, and that was disabled people that have mobility allowance back, which was from a lot of lobbying. And then I realized here in Cork that you're one of the first local county councils that passed the motion of travelers being an ethnic minority group. So for me, they're small, and in the larger picture, the small things matter more than the big in the matter. And of course, and there are lots of borrowed cliches, but at the moment, the realism in austerity means that we're able to get a rash perspective lens to look back. And you know what? I'd rather be hurt with the truth than be fooled by a lie. I think this moment of isolation, of vulnerability, of fear, of almost navel-gazing has made us sit still and realize the 60s weren't all that bad.
The only question that was directed was Rory's, and I tweeted from up here before I stood up, and Rory slagged me on Twitter for tweeting, and then some, one of your other members who's not here wanted me to tweet from the podium, the cheek. So if that wasn't up there, I'd be having very cheeky banter with Rory over his question. Of course, there's a point. There's a huge point, and Rosalie's just summed it up so well. But that's one of the things I was trying to get across, is that if nothing else, let's start talking about the kind of society we want to have, and put some distance, I hope, between ourselves and the neoliberal and other values that lead to what you've described so eloquently, and lead to, you know, the thought that a public station would be, broadcasting station would be closed down, and all of the workers laid off. And I mean, the stuff that's come out of Russia in the last few days is just absolutely unbelievable. So of course, I think, and I agree with Rosalie, she put it much more eloquently, so I won't try and
repeat it.
No, I won't. Certainly will not. But I do think that, and some days I think that's all we have, is to sit back and look at this opportunity and really ask ourselves very hard questions about how we got here. And I think there's a big resistance to doing that, because people feel, oh, we don't want to go over it all again, and it's overwhelming. It's a bit like trying to understand the HSE. I don't know how the minister does it, because you're reading about the HSE and it feels overwhelming and you kind of want to run a mile. But I think it's really important that we sit still, as Rosalie has put it so eloquently, and really think about, well, how did we get here? And it's wonderful to bash Fianna Fáil, and no better woman to do it, and to blame them. But what is society, where are we at? And where do we want to end up being at? So I think that's the point, Rory, if nothing else, on the worst days. But I do think that this is one of the reasons why I was very glad for this opportunity, because I feel very guilty as a community leader in Open and elsewhere, and on the board of the Women's Council and the other things that I do, that in some ways I think that our sector, with a few notable exceptions, including Belong To, has become very inward focusing in terms of trying to survive as organisations, trying to survive as leaders. And I do think it's really important we open up now. That's why I said what I said. There's loads of things I could have said this evening. And by the way, I was asked to be provocative. So I think I'm very rude coming down here and giving a hell about the government. I was asked to be, but I think it's important, and I think it's important that we start opening up again and asking the wider questions about society. That's the point for me. Very long-winded, sorry.
I think that, I don't know, maybe just to be personal about it, actually, because you've kind of said all the political stuff, which is absolutely amazing, but I often remember that, I think when I was speaking of, I mentioned around the suicide prevention strategy and LGBT people being named and stuff like that, but that was one of the hardest professional battles I remember ever having. But at the same time that was happening, I was working with a young transgender woman. She was 14 at the time, and she'd been committed to a mental institution, basically, having attempted suicide. And I had a very good relationship with her. I was a youth worker with her, and I remember I used to go to these meetings with other NGOs and government bodies and stuff like that around like what's going to be in the next suicide prevention strategy. I remember finding it really tough and actually experiencing real homophobia at meetings, you know, and basically being told the gays are trying to hijack the issue of suicide at these meetings. I remember thinking this was really, really tough. But I remember then going out one evening at St. John of God's to visit this young woman that I was working with, and just having a conversation with her and seeing what she had gone through. I remember thinking, like, it was almost like, I remember at the time thinking, oh my God, this is as low as a human being could possibly be made feel. And it was incredibly motivating. You know, it was incredibly motivating to kind of go, well, I mean, I'm not there. You know what I mean? I have so much I can do here. You know what I mean? There's such a sense of, I felt so privileged, and I felt that if this young woman had to go through that every day, I mean, the least I could do was go into a room and argue on her behalf, you know? And I think that's a thing of, like, sometimes the worst situations can be incredibly motivating, and maybe that's what the point is.
Okay, are there any more questions? Yes, one down back, and this gentleman here.
Hi, I was just wondering that in a panel that's sort of discussing challenging privilege and tackling social exclusion, that there was the issue of migrants and the migrant community, the ethnic minority communities in Ireland, have been completely absent from the discussion. So there's no reference to the social exclusion, racism and marginalisation that community faces. And I think, I just wanted to ask the question, really, why was this? I mean, was this a pilot, was this a neglect, or was it just intention?
Joan Feely. My comments are directed to Rosalie here. Excellent talk. On the issue of Traveller Training Centre, I was involved to try and keep the Traveller Training Centre going in Carrick and Shannon. And while it was quite expensive, the argument being used at the time for its closure, which I think won the day, unfortunately, was that Pabby Point was for closure. But of course, the bit you highlighted, yes, you wanted a mainstream, but that the money should be allocated to some other activity. And of course, that bit was, as far as I can see, forgotten about. It was a saving of money, primarily. And then the second point I would make, some years ago I was canvassing in Sligo and visited a national school. And the principal of that school had quite a large number of travellers. And he said to me, well, one of the reasons I have turned this to the benefit of the school, because he was getting quite a large premium, and he was able to convince the parents who were initially pulling their kids out of the school to another school, look, we are going to benefit immensely by having travellers here, because I'm going to be able to get this, and which he got. So, bluntly, resources can sometimes overcome the certain aspects of inequality. So, well, that bit of transfers to our minister here, that really resources have to be used and used effectively.
Is there a third question? Yeah, Deirdre.
I was just wondering, at the last party conference, both Labour Youth and Labour Equality had motions around reforming the equality proofing process of the budget. And we haven't heard anything to the effect that there's a discussion going on, particularly around implementing the European semester and the way the budget's being brought forward. There doesn't seem to be much an indication that there is discussion happening around how we might reform, how we assess objectively the equality impacts of our budgets. So I was just wondering if the panelists have views on what their kind of ideal process would be. I know it's of course a subjective thing, it's impossible to have a perfect methodology for it, but what do you feel might be missing from the process at the moment, and how could we, you know, improve it so that the equality impacts of national budgets for this government and future governments could be made very clear, and the decisions and the process itself could be made perhaps more fair or equality promotion, because fair is a very subjective word to use and not very scientific.
It's very true.
Could you? Could you? Rose, think of it? Sorry, okay, well, yeah. And I won't remember. Henry Ford, I asked Michael and Francis, my true Labour Party spirit, that I am. Racism isn't just my responsibility, it's all of us.
Yes.
And you might comment as well on
yes.
Travel issues. And I any form of segregated employment, accommodation, education, whether you're a migrant, whether you're disabled, whether you're a traveler. Nobody wants that. People want choice, and they also want some sort of affirmative measures to rebalance the past. When my generation, my mother's generation, and her mother didn't have an opportunity to go to school, let alone vocational training. And then I would add that in the larger picture, travelers in university and second level are way below the average. Now I haven't the stats printed on my head, I should have, but I don't. But I do know they're way below, something like 0.5%. I would also say the woman in the back, when she talked about why, what was the question around, I suppose, I didn't know how to answer it, but again I would say, and Michael and Brandon, in all of our work, in all of our sector, in all of our human rights work, there are gay travelers, there are migrant people who are gay, there are migrant women who are alone, their parents. You know, it's... And then the thing about privilege as well, that's more that I feel all of us, even me, have power and privilege dependent on the context. And for me, as a human rights activist, I must always be reminded of my power and privilege before I can be reminded of what I don't have. Does that make sense? Maybe Francis and Michael would say something as well.
Sure. Other question, if you want to speak some racism. So I imagine you mean why isn't there a representation of from migrant groups and migrant people here? Is that what you mean?
Well, it's just that I think the issue in general, I think it's been ignored, even if you look right through the program for the whole weekend.
Oh yeah.
And I was very disappointed when
sure.
I saw it.
Sure.
And I just wondered.
Oh yeah, maybe I guess I can't speak for the organisers, but maybe you weren't here when I was speaking. But I spent.
I did. Absolutely. I appreciate that.
Maybe it is an interesting point though as well. That within migrant communities there are some communities as well that are particularly kind of at risk very often.
But
I would say genuinely that I think at the moment for the young people that we work with, very often the young people are most at very real risk. I mean, risk in terms of life and death are young LGBT asylum seekers, refugees that we work with. It's extremely vulnerable group.
It's funny because when I was going over my speech last night, I did think about clarifying that I was talking about geographical communities, but communities of interest as well, but it's a very fair point. The other point is, of course, that there are lone parents in direct provision who don't get the 188 plus 2980 that people...
Yeah, the biggest group, actually, in direct provision. Sector.
Yeah, particularly in Mosnia, I know, because we did some work with them. I know your wider question was to the organisers, so I won't go there, but I do think that there is a whole question about, and I suppose it goes back to the earlier thing that I was trying to say about opening up, you know, I suppose constantly reflecting on the diversity within your own organisation, whether that's at the policy level or whatever. So I think it's a very fair point. And certainly there are, you know, within some communities there are issues about becoming a lone parent to do with the fact that you're a migrant or a traveller, you know, or an ethnic minority, because marriage, opposite sex marriage is held up, particularly for women, as the desirable thing. So there's a whole lot of work
there is,
to be done. And while I have the mic, so we're going to have to pass it back up again, just to go to Deirdre's point, I mean, absolutely we need equality budgeting and we need scrutiny. And I mean, the fact that on the one hand, I mean, it just drives me insane that on the one hand, the budget can be poverty-proofed and said, yes, 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 it's, you know, people are not worse off, and then the department a few months later can produce this, which shows that lone parents were the worst affected by the budget. So you're like, well, how can you have... So it just shows that the poverty-proofing exercise has become a bit of a nonsense and a joke. And if you were to go across the equality grounds, presumably, just like the earlier point, you'd be looking at, you know, how different grounds are affected. So it's certainly something that needs to happen. I mean, I think, to be fair to the current government, you know, it's not as if... It's not. I don't think the current government is as opposed to it as previous governments were. I think part of the problem is that the system is not very good at knitting itself together. And the big, if you look at across the board, like childcare is the classic example of policy failure even during the boom. There's no way that childcare can be the responsibility of one government department. So if you're asking people to implement something that goes across things, it's really, the system finds that really difficult. But you're absolutely right, it does need to happen. And it is good that your party conference passed that. And I think that certainly we do need to look at, you know, poverty impact statements when we're even outside the budget, when we're developing new policies. You know, how will this impact in particular on people in poverty? So, for example, if we're looking at mental health, how will it impact, how will, you know, what the minister is trying to do, the important work that she's trying to do, the impacts for people who have private health insurance, the impacts for people who don't, for example. There are very, it's complicated, but there are also very straightforward questions we could be asking. So, I mean, it is good that at least one of the parties in the current government is looking at it.
And just to follow on from Francis, I'm not certain that it's something that you can do while you're in actually negotiating the budget, because I think it is far more complicated than each department simply going in and arguing their case in terms of their own particular budget. I think it's a bigger piece of work than that. There's probably a more long-term piece of work than that, and maybe every department needs to put its own, if you like, strategies in place in ensuring that that doesn't happen. And so I think it is more long-term, and we'll be going into the budget process very shortly again, because we're now going to have it in October, and I think it's about bringing it into line to the European norm. But, you know, going in there, you're going to be arguing on all sorts of levels, and I think equality proving, as Francis has rightly said, is a little bit more complicated than that. I would hate to think that going in there that someone suddenly got the notion that we should all be equal, so therefore we should all come down to the same level. That would worry me. I think it's a bit more complicated than that. Could I just, if you don't mind, just address the traveller issue, because it's something that I always had a particular interest in. And I don't mean from a sort of voyeuristic point of view, you know, it's just it's an issue I've always felt that we should have been able to do far more with. Basically a number of years ago, I visited a particular after school program, won't say where, and when I went in, there were two groups of children. And one group of children were in the outside room, and another group of children were in the inside room. It didn't really matter, but they just were separate groups. And they were about the same age. And there was the same mix of, you know, boy, girl, you know, thing. And primary school kids, now we're talking about primary school kids. And one of the groups was, by the way, they were all traveller children. And one of the groups were, you know, doing the usual sort of, you know, the comic book and the colouring in and, you know, what kids do. And the other group were doing their homework. And, you know, I said to the woman whom I happen to know, one group is way quicker at doing the homework than the other. And she said, actually, no, she said. Group of kids, she said, in that room, now we were well removed at this stage, the group of kids, she said, in that room, she said, actually can't read and write. the other group of kids, she said, in the other room, she said, can all read and write.
What do you mean by that?
Well, I don't want to be too specific now, Rosalie, and I'll talk to you later,
I don't want to identify, but if you're going to make that kind of a statement, you need to explain why not.
Okay, then let me tell you what I did. I actually went and spoke to one of the people that deliver education in the city. And I pointed this out to him, and he has been now in constant contact with that particular school. I do believe, Rosalie, having, and this was now a few years ago, I do believe that it was about, I suppose a lack of expectation on behalf of that school. Now, it wasn't that the children didn't have the ability to learn how to read and write. They clearly did. But it was a lack of expectation, and hopefully, and it wasn't to do with the children, it was to do with the people delivering the service. Hopefully, that's been dealt with. But I do think that we have to be very careful, and it must always be about outcomes. Always be about outcomes.
And just to say this very quickly, because I know people aren't here to hear me, the point about there being voices missing from the panel, I mean, that's undoubtedly true. I don't know who was contacted and who wasn't, and how it worked out in terms of how the panel was formed, but I think it is an unfortunate thing.
Yes, Brian, can I just address that point as chairperson of Labour Youth? And we did actually go, and Lisa went to great personal lengths to try and contact someone from these groups to actually have someone present, but they couldn't make it. And we've actually had two events over the last year as Labour Youth addressing those issues specifically. So, and also, we kind of thought that Rosaline was here in this capacity as well, because as we all know, you don't have to be from another country to experience racism in this country. So, that's kind of the perspective that we're coming from. We've also done great work over the last year in building up our links with these types of organisations like the Migrant Rights Centre and the Africa Centre. And we were actually the first political organisation to be present this year at Africa Day in Dublin. And that was mainly down to the work of Lisa and our recruitment officer, Ciarán Garrett. So, and another point I thought I made myself personally, you don't even need to look at the panel, you need to look around the room just in general, and I think it's very real to say that, there is a genuine underrepresentation of these people in Irish politics, and I have to agree with you.
Okay, thanks, Aidan. We have, I think, about 5 minutes left, so if there are any questions, preferably for the whole panel, but not necessarily, yeah.
This is specifically about mental health, but I'm sure from your own organisation's dealing with media, you might have something to offer on it. It's just to see what kind of an audit can be done, Kathleen, in particular with the media and local media as well, in dealing with cases of mental health, where in Kilkenny last week we had a very distraught parent who was a teacher in a secondary school, which my daughter went to, so I know the woman in question, who has a 20-something-year-old son who has, mental issues over the years, and was out on day release last week and had an episode. And how it was treated, in particularly on the local radio, was as if somebody from Al-Qaeda had dropped into the middle of the city and had created this stand-up. And how it was treated top of the hour, every hour for the following day, was just appalling. And it resulted in the mother of the young man ringing up and saying, "This is my son. He is not a lunatic that, just decided to take up a machete in the middle of the street one day. He was just out on release and he has a mental illness. And please, would you not be reporting it?" And they said, "Well, that's the story and we're sticking with it." So I don't know if there's an internal audit. I know some of your own organisations, like you were mentioning as well, how sometimes in the media it's a very sexy topic and then, what you deal with, and other times it's not, that it takes maybe a big tragedy for the media to actually turn around and identify some of the serious and very personal cases that you deal with. But if there is some way that an audit could be done, and maybe then as a result guidelines put in place for stations and the press in general to deal with these cases.
Are there any other final questions?
No, okay, just go with that.
Could I just say that the amazing thing is that there are sort of agreed guidelines, but they are only guidelines in relation to suicide and media. You know, sometimes, I'm not going to say tabloid, I'm not going to say that, because I think that somehow sort of excuses some reporting. But some newspapers don't deal with it, as well as they should. But the majority of mainstream papers actually deal with it quite well. You know, they don't sensationalise it unless it's someone that we're all acutely aware of. We've had a few instances of that. But once again, I just think, there is not a newspaper now, not a radio programme, not a television programme, not a group that meets, and that's a typical example of what I'm going to say. No group now meets, whether it's in the pub, in a setting like this, that mental health doesn't come up in the conversation. That's an enormous step forward in the last few years. An enormous step forward. And, we have to be conscious of that, conscious of the fact that we have made huge strides in relation to our attitudes towards mental health. But in saying that, it's nearly as if it's okay to talk about the soft focus stuff. Depression, Rory waking at 4 a.m. It's nearly okay. That's one of the signs, Rory. I said I didn't do a subtlety, but anyway. But could I just say that I just do think that it's nearly okay to talk about the soft focus stuff, that to talk about the depression and to talk about the days when we don't want to get out of bed and which one of us haven't had that. It's okay. But it's always then the acute phase where we think that the person is going to appear, as Mags rightly said, with the machete. As if somehow or other there were 10 people a week dying at the hands of people who have a mental illness. And they don't, and it's not true. And I think it's needing to get into that harder stuff. The harder stuff. The psychosis. And that psychosis, by the way, always begins in sort of mid to late teens. Always begins at that stage. And it's very difficult to spot because it's nearly sort of the chaos of being a teenager. Or it's put down to sort of drugs or drink or something like that. And it's not most of the time. It's that kind of chaos. And the early intervention actually works. And obviously that young man was having the type of treatment that he needed. But we need to start, as I say, the guidelines around suicide. Okay, people breach them from time to time, but they are there. But we need to have the discussion about the more difficult stuff. I always quote Barbara Brennan when I'm talking about mental illness, and she knows this, so it's okay. And Barbara Brennan, at a talk I was at one night, stood up and gave an incredible speech. She's a very... she's a very gregarious young woman. She's an artist by profession. She's an incredibly articulate young woman. And she stood up and she said, "My name is Barbara Brennan and I'm bipolar." And just like he, there wasn't a sound. She said, "Do you not think that's peculiar? What if I stood up and said, my name is Barbara Brennan and I'm chest infection?" So it's really getting the conversation to a point that we, not just the person themselves, but that we ensure that the condition doesn't define the person. And that when someone has an episode of poor mental health, and I know that, if you were inside my kitchen from time to time, you would say, "Geez, she's really lost it." But, it's this fear, it's the absolute fear around the whole thing. And there's no need. There is no need. And I do think that we maybe need to bring in the press council and talk to them around the whole issue of mental health, but not just the soft stuff, guys. Not just, the days when you're feeling down and the days when you're feeling depressed and, the little, not just about that,
but about the difficult, hard stuff as well. And I think we're inclined to talk about it in soft focus. So maybe we need, maybe there's another step we need to take.
Before I did it, and I asked people not to preach whatever I was to say, it's very sensitive, so please don't preach. We all know from public debates about depression and mental health issues, the stigma and shame attached to that. And we all know from gay people and travelers and from other marginalized groups that we carry internalized shame. And therefore, we're at risk. We're at multiple risks. That's what the term is. And last week, and again, I would really ask you, please don't preach. Last week, I got a phone call from a young traveling woman who had been on my big fat gypsy wins. And this woman had been exposed, violated, vulnerable. And this was her third attempt at taking her own life. And this is how we treat young people on the margins. They don't always have access to mental health services around the clock on a Friday evening till Monday morning. They don't always have someone that will know appropriate culturally ways of dealing with someone. They don't always have access to a service provider who has anti-homophobic training or awareness. But more importantly, Barbara asked the question about organizations having, what was the question? Having guidelines are proven for the media. In the NGO sector, particularly in the travel sector, we're just about dealing with the phenomena that everyone in our family knows someone who has died or killed themselves. We're not even beginning to look at how we audit that, how we prove it, how we prevent it. It's such, when, and I don't mean to be ignorant or smart, but when we hear, particularly on public debates, talk of male suicide, it's all done in a very middle class kind of way of dealing with stuff. And I'm not sure there is a way of dealing with stuff. But I do think that the debate, and I know Kathleen has really, really pushed it and has really invested money in travel mental health services, but I still don't think the debate has filtered down into the margins of how small inflows of marginalized young people deal with this stuff. There's so much stuff being thrown at them. Anyway, I should have.
I think the other thing as well is that, and mostly you're quite right, I mean, the rate of suicide within the travel community, especially young men, as you know, is 7 times higher than in the city.
And that's only the ones we know about.
Yeah, and the ones we count, I suppose, because we probably know about the others as well, Rosalie, but there's the proof issue is there as well. But again, I mean, I would repeat what Rosalie said, because it's such a sensitive issue, maybe tweeting might be the best thing for this, but Shane McEntee, I mean, you know, like no matter what we think of politicians,
you know, we're going to have to start to be more respectful of one another. And I would fall right across the board now with that, Rosalie. I mean, just respectful of people. You know, no matter who you are, no matter what you are, you know, just that sheer sense of respect. And I think it's that sort of, that lack of respect sometimes that eventually gets to people. It's very distraught that broke the camel's back. And, you know, people in marginalised communities, you know, but what does strike me, Rosalie, always about the whole suicide issue is that it, I think to a great extent, you can understand it when people are under severe financial pressure or under severe social pressures, or there is an element of maybe intimidation within their own community, or indeed a type of racist slurs that are constantly, that's nearly understandable where that comes from, you know, why people then choose to take their own life by suicide. They shouldn't, but you know what the compound effect of all of that is. But when you then take someone, you know, like Shane McEntee, who you would think, you know, didn't have any problems or, you know, didn't have any difficulties, as you rightly say, it is such a complex area that it's very difficult to know what is that spark that finally pushes people over the edge. But the only thing I would say to you is that in terms of traveller community, and I think in terms of other communities as well in relation to migrants and centres, the stuff we're developing, or the stuff we have developed, and we're looking at a new strategy, as you know, really isn't appropriate in some cases. It simply isn't appropriate in some cases. You know, we are going, you know, it's as if we're a homogenous group and it's always the same issue that pushes us over the edge. And that's not true. That's not true. Whether it's in relation to people that are gay or transgender or migrants or travellers or any one of us, it's different. It is different. And I think we need to start that separation out. You know,
it's kind of almost one of the unintended consequences to quote Ronan Munnam, where one of the chances.
No need for that. Ever.
No, I do think just from working in the whole area of youth mental health, I think one of the consequences of this kind of newer narrative, which is that mental health difficulties can affect anybody,
yes,
has been this kind of almost mainstreaming of all mental health issues, which I kind of think actually isn't great, you know, in a lot of ways, because this idea that every young person is vulnerable to suicide, it kind of whitewashes all the social factors underneath that, you know. I mean, certain groups of young people are much more vulnerable than others do.
Stuff.
Yeah, it's kind of not, you know, it's not always helpful. I can see why, I can see how it's come about.
Yes.
It's just like national dialogue that we can now talk about mental health. So I think it actually comes from a good place, not a bad place, but that's one of the consequences of it. But actually, one of the things as well I've noticed, and I've been involved a small bit in work with the press around how they report youth mental health, is that they can be very good at sometimes, but if you remember last year, again, not getting into any particular details, but this terrible tragedy in Donegal where two family members committed suicide, the media certainly didn't behave very well in that case. And I think the reason for that was because the internet as such was kind of infiltrated in this tragedy, you know. So the news story wasn't necessarily this young woman's death at the first member of the family, but was cyberbullying and was essentially, I mean, sorry to be blunt about it, but it was almost like the internet is killing our children. And it's this thing that's just playing into the worst possible fears of parents, and that kind of stuff sells newspapers. So I think, as Minister Lynch said, that there are guidelines there, but they're just guidelines, and when there's an opportunity to sell newspapers by selling fear, I think the newspapers still will definitely go there.
It just struck me as I was listening to your question. I mean, I agree, and I think Minister summed it up very well. Like, one of the things, obviously the worst thing that has happened during austerity is the increase in suicide, or whether it's the increase in reporting about suicide, but I do think that it has opened up, you know, as the Minister said, people are talking about mental health, but it is people aren't talking about mental illness, though. And I think that's a big problem, and I wouldn't put it all in the media. I think Michael is right. I think as a society we need to start talking about it. But there is a very fine line. A few years ago, Jack mentioned that governments have put me on things, and one of the things I was put on by one, I think which previous government it was a
an NESF team looking at mental health, and Dan Neville, who I think has been a tremendous champion in this area, he startled me one evening. We were taking out for this very posh dinner, Gobby with the Days, some hotel a week ago for a thinking. Wouldn't happen now. We barely get a cup of coffee, you know. But he did make a really, I mean, it really startled me, because this isn't an area that I'm an expert in at all, apart from being, you know, having my own battles like we all have. But in terms of my daily job, the work that Michael has done, we haven't done enough of it, and we'd like to do more in Open. But he said, we need to remove the stigma about mental health and mental illness, but never remove the stigma about suicide. And I was really shocked. I said, Dad, you're a child. And he said, no, because suicide visits all kinds of tragedy and pain. And sometimes I hear the reporting and I kind of wince. And I go, but hang on, this is a terrible tragedy, and we have to talk about and not be soft about it and interrogate the reasons. And I know that we have very active membership in Finglas, and there have been a spike even before the bust of, it's actually been described as such by psychiatrists, a spike of suicides in Finglas. And at one stage, and no more than quoting Roman Mullen, I'm not fond of or not known for quoting Catholic priests, some of whom have terrible track records of, you know, shoving Sonia O'Sullivan, etc., out of churches for having children outside wedlock. But a particular local priest in Finglas West lost, and I don't want this tweeted, please, like Rosalind said, lost the plot one day at a particular funeral, because he realised that there were some young people in the coming to the funerals, treating them as a day out, and getting all dressed up, and etc., and celebrating the person's life, and to become glorification. And he lost the plot at one of the funerals, and he was quite right. So I do think all of these issues are confronting us, and I think it's good that we're talking about them. It's terrible, though, that what happened in your area. It's just unthinkable. And it reminds me, you know, and albeit forgiving some of the stuff about the media in relation to the internet and, you know, Twitter breaking stories and report, I don't know how many times there's various people who I won't mention who have died on Twitter, and they haven't died at all. Anyway, I shouldn't be joking, but, you know. But also, like, coming up to the budget, I mean, we would get phone calls, and I know another national organisation that has told me that my equivalent, another national organisation, has said, the next time she gets one of these calls, she's going to, you know, say, yeah, we have a laboratory in the basement where we grow them. But sometimes we're actually asked for the blonde mother of two, but, you know, we want one in poverty, Frances, kind of thing. So I do think there's a whole thing about the media and the way poverty's portrayed, the way mental health and mental illness are described and portrayed, but I think it's all of our work. And I think it's terrible that mother of that young man had to ring up. Everybody in that community needs to ring
distraught.
Up.
Distraught.
Yeah.
Distraught.
Okay, so I think we'll wrap it up there. There's going to be a 10-minute break now before our keynote speaker. So I'd like to thank everyone for coming, and to thank our panelists, Michael, Frances, Kathleen, Rosalie, and Julia.